Hello, hey. Now we're talking. This is awesome. Unfortunate for you guys, it works. yeah, they had to put a cloth on here from first service. I was drooling and spitting so bad. Actually, I think it's for the sound, but no, thanks. I'm really blessed by getting to preach again. It's a good morning. And today we're moving on to kind of the next part in our series. And this year we've been talking about growth and maturing in discipleship, as Dave already mentioned this morning. And what we've kind of went through this year, just to recap, is that first we talked about, you know, the difference between immature and mature and how they respond in different circumstances. Then from that we moved to how to properly judge as Christians, how we're called to judge inside the church and not outside the church to people that haven't agreed to the standards of Christ. But yet for the body of Christ, we're called to hold a standard and to keep them accountable. And then we paused with Paul to remember the gospel. As it's easy, as we're maturing and we're looking into spiritual disciplines, it's easy to kind of start getting work-based and starting to thinking, well, maybe I just can earn my salvation. Or maybe Jesus' death wasn't enough. But we paused with Paul that day, and we learned that, once again, we're reminded that we're saved by Jesus Christ's finished work on the cross. And then out of that knowledge, that gives us pursuit and gratitude to go pursue God in obedience because of all he's done for us. And then last week, we're encouraged to look at our spiritual disciplines and be motivated and focused in all that we do, to run the race well, and to have our eyes on the prize. And the purpose of maturing in our faith and being self-disciplined isn't just to be a better us or just to, you know, have us look good, but is to mature and be spiritually disciplined to help our witness in the world. And the prize that we seek are the lost souls outside of this church and maybe some inside the church. That we're supposed to seek them, and that's our prize, and that's why we train and diligently seek the Lord so that more can be saved. And now we come against the one thing that kind of tries to keep us from all that, and that's temptation. So let's pray, and then we can dive right into 1 Corinthians chapter 10. But Father God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this church. Lord, the ways you blessed us with this body of Christ. God, this morning I pray that whatever you have in store for us, God, whether it's conviction or encouragement, or whether you called us here to equip us further, God, whatever it is, I just pray that your will can be done. We have come here with open hearts, for that your spirit can move freely in this place, and that your will can be done. And God, I just pray for myself that you can give me words to speak, and you let nothing false come from my mouth this morning. Pray this in your holy and precious name, Jesus. Amen. So temptation, it seems like it doesn't matter if we're just walking through the mundane of life or we're like pursuing the greatest efforts for Christ. Temptation is going to be calling and trying to pull us away. Trying to strip us, as Dave mentioned earlier, try to pull us into despair and pull us away from the promises that Christ has given us. That we're loved and we're cherished and we're forgiven. That we're not alone. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 is where we're going to start. And in this, keep your finger here throughout the day, because we're going to kind of be going back to this. We're going to be going in James, and we're going to kind of be flipping back and forth. But keep your finger here. But chapter 10, verse 13, it says this: "No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape, that you may be able to endure it." I'll read that one more time. "No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, he will also provide a way of escape, that you may be able to endure it." All the temptations we face every single day. I'm just getting bombarded constantly. I mean, whether it's about gossiping about a relative or a coworker or a classmate, you know, wanting to speak our mind and, you know, in anger and in strong emotion, or whether it's, you know, to spend God's money, you know, carelessly, and then we get to church and it's like, well, we got to save because we're broke. We can't really, you know, be giving money to everything. You know, to lust in our hearts and minds, to be looking at pornography, to take just one more drink or one more plate or one more look. The temptation to leave a little dust on your Bible for the sake of an extra episode or one more check on your to-do list. The temptation to not accept our responsibilities that we have as husbands and wives, as fathers and mothers, and as sons and daughters. The temptation to be lazy or to look really good in front of other people instead of showing them our brokenness and struggles. Or a more recent one, the temptation to maybe be more concerned about our national security than the Great Commission. And I could list more and more and more, and the truth of the matter is that no one knows what you're struggling with the temptations that are always pulling on you, than yourself. So let's take a good look at temptation this morning and look at how we can battle it just in practical ways, ways based on Scripture, that we can take on temptation every single day as mature Christians. And I think to start that, keep your hand on 1 Corinthians chapter 10, but then we have to go and turn to James chapter 1, verse 13. So turn to James chapter 1, verse 13. And it says this. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. The first thing we have to get straight when we're looking at temptation is that God does not tempt. No one can say it's God who's tempting me. Let no man say that. And we sometimes hear that, oh, this is God's fault, or, you know, God made me this way. Well, if God would have just done this or that, well, then it would have been different. And we can't say that because God tempts no one. And then going back to 1 Corinthians, same part we started, chapter 10, verse 13, the second half of that verse says two promises of God's role in temptation. And that's what we're looking at right now, is what's God's role in temptation, and then what's our role in temptation. So the first role that God has in temptation is that he doesn't tempt. Number two, as it says in verse 13 here, that God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. So God does not tempt, and when we are tempted, he will not let us be tempted beyond our ability. And number three, if we continue reading that verse, but with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape, that you will be able to endure it. So God will also provide, while we're being tempted, a way of escape, which is a good promise to have. And now this really caught me off guard. Now going back to James, we're flipping back and forth, I know a lot, is in chapter 1, that next verse, and now it's our role. So what's God's role? It's God does not tempt. When we are tempted, he won't let us be tempted beyond our ability. And number three, that God will provide a way out or a way of escape when we're falling under temptation. Now, our role in James chapter 1, verse 14. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by, what does it say there? His own desire. I think that's very interesting. Because since the beginning of time, we like to play the blame game. After the first original sin, what happened? God comes to Adam, and he's like, hey, did you eat the fruit? And Adam's like, you know, pointing fingers, well, the woman you made me, God, and she made me do it. And then he looks over at Eve, and Eve's like, well, the serpent made me do it. What are you talking about? We love to point the finger, but I want you guys to hear this today. We can't be tempted by something we don't think looks good. Does that make sense? We can't be tempted by something we think doesn't look good. If somebody brings up a piece of bacon right now with a bunch of, you know, mold on it and a piece of hair, I'm going to probably pass. But if somebody brings up one that's still sizzling, that's thick cut, you know, double smoked hickory, I'm going to go for it. Simple as that, because it looks good. So what you truly desire in your heart is what's going to tempt you. It's as simple as that, and that makes sense. I mean, it's kind of like, duh, but until we really say it, I mean, if you didn't desire it in some level, it wouldn't be very tempting to you. I mean, there's a desire we have with temptations, like, yeah, I want that. I would rather have that than what the Lord has waiting for me. It looks attractive. So what you truly desire is what's going to tempt you. So as mature Christians this morning, we're going to look at four ways. We got to know ourselves if we're going to fight temptation. We have to know Scripture. We have to know the outcome. And we have to know the gospel or the forgiveness that Christ offers. So that's where we're going this morning. So number one, we have to know ourselves. We have to know where we fail and where we succeed. And instead of just trying to continue in the same situation of like, man, I've screwed up in that situation about 9 times. Well, maybe the 10th time's a charm, you know? It doesn't really normally work like that. If we're weak in a certain area of our faith walk or a certain area in our life, the odds are that we're going to continue to stumble in it. That the desire just might be too strong for us, whatever that temptation is. So number one, as mature Christians, we have to acknowledge it. We have to acknowledge that, okay, I'm weak in this area, and then what do? We got to start avoiding it. You got to know your strengths, know your weaknesses, and when you know that you're going to go into a losing situation, you got to put the brakes on. I think when me and Erica were dating, and for us, you know, we're trying to live a pure lifestyle within dating. So we set boundaries for ourselves that we don't want to cross lines, that you know, that we can stay pure. But there were situations that if we fell into, we knew that the odds were going to be against us and we'd probably fail in some way and cross the lines that we had set. So, you know, if it was about being at my parents' house or her parents' house without, you know, anybody else being around and we're alone, that was pretty much a lose-lose situation every time. So with that, it was like, okay, we had to just communicate that. Hey, if I come over to your house, who's all going to be there? Well, my brother and my sister. Okay, that's cool. We can do that. If not, then what else are we going to do? Let's go for a walk. Let's do something else. Or maybe you're coming to my house today. Because we didn't want to put ourselves in a position to fail. When it comes to temptation, unfortunately, it seems we can't really give ourselves the benefit of the doubt. With the brokenness and the evil desires of our hearts, the odds are that we're going to fail. And I don't want to sound too pessimistic, but when it comes to temptation, I think it's sometimes safe to assume failure. To assume that I'm going to fail again if I put myself in that situation. And I'm a firm believer in this as well, that the way of escape, so one of God's roles that he was promising us in temptation, that he was going to offer us a way of escape. One of those ways of escape, or maybe the main way of escape, is saying, I want you to avoid it before you even get there. I want you to see it coming, and I'm going to put a red flag and say, hey, right here, this is the trap, this is what you always get, go another direction. And that's a way of escape that God's going to be offering you in times of temptation. And I've been a firm believer that the way of escape is probably before you dive into it. But I've been looking for scripture on that, and a few months ago the Lord gave me this. I want you guys to turn to John chapter 11. It's the Gospel of John chapter 11. And we're going to start right at verse 1. And this is the death of Lazarus. So I'll start. It says, now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Martha who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him, saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, the illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, so when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea. Now I'm skipping ahead to verse 14. It says, then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died, and for your sake I'm glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Now you might be like, okay, Greg, what the heck does this have to do with temptation? I didn't hear it once. It doesn't look like it's a tempting situation. But remember this, that we are tempted by what we most desire, right? If we don't desire to do it, it's not going to be a temptation. Jesus Christ being so awesome and so pure and perfect that he desires to do good. It's not even the evil that necessarily, you know, slicks him up sometimes. It's the good situation that he's tempted to do. And Jesus knows that the will of the Father is not to heal Lazarus here. The will of the Father is to raise Lazarus from the dead. And Jesus knows himself. So Jesus knows, okay, I know myself, I know my heart, and if I go to Judea right now and I see Lazarus in pain, and I see Mary and Martha sitting at the bedside weeping and crying, my heart's going to be moved. And it says this, because isn't this weird? It says, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. So it's kind of like, well, if you loved him, go. But he stays. He doesn't want to put himself in the situation because he knows if he gets there, he sees it, he's going to be led to heal Lazarus. And if Jesus heals Lazarus, then Jesus doesn't need to raise Lazarus from the dead. So Jesus was tempted to do something good, but would have been wrong because God wanted to do something great. Jesus stayed out of a situation that he knew his heart would be torn and he would be tempted in a great way. And in the same way, we have to know ourselves, know the situations we're going to get into, and not put ourselves in that situation. See, I don't think it's about getting in the jail cell and then being like, all right, Lord, now you promised a way of escape. Let me MacGyver this sucker, you know? I don't think that's what it is. I think God's like, I didn't want you to get in the jail cell in the first place. Just don't go in. Avoid it. Go around it. Do whatever you can. Because once you're in it, the sober and clear mind that Christ calls us to normally seems to no longer be present. As soon as you're alone with a boyfriend or girlfriend, you're not thinking straight. The hormones are clicked in, you're gone. As soon as somebody says, you know, hey, do you want a drink? And you know you can't have it. I mean, if you put yourself in that situation, you're probably toast. As soon as somebody says, hey, let's go, you know, let's go to the casino and gamble, and you know you got a problem, as soon as you're hanging around with that person, you're toast. As soon as somebody says, do you really want to forgive them? The temptation just to hold bitterness in your heart? The voice you get when it's like, hey, maybe we should just go turn on the computer. No one's around. You're toast. Don't put yourself in a position to fail. So as mature Christians, we need to be proactive. We need to devise a plan. We have to know that we need accountability. We need the church. We need support. And we got to know our strengths and weaknesses. Because immature Christians, it's willy-nilly. It's kind of like, well, let's just stumble into the day again. You know, we'll just stumble across my new temptations, some old ones, and we'll just kind of see how it plays out. You know, we'll just hope for the best and kind of see what happens. But as mature Christians in Christ, we're not called just to go in aimlessly, no plan, no nothing. It's time to get serious about temptation. And if there's things that you continue to struggle with, you know those situations, where they always show up in your life, what group of people it happens with when you're around, or what group of people's not around when it happens with, however it might look. And mature Christians, we have to have an accurate self-assessment and know ourselves. That's point one. Number two, mature Christians know Scripture. Now, for the sake of time, I'm not going to go into Jesus getting tempted in the wilderness. But for those that take notes, the reference I'll give you is Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. But mature Christians have to know Scripture. Understand the truth, so when the temptation comes and the lies are offered you of this is what this is going to be, we know we can see right through it. I mean, this is our sword. And we're walking into a battle every single day, and none of us would go into a battle without being like, yeah, I'll just wear the armor, you know, I'll just kind of see how it goes. We got to have a sword, and it's either got to be in our hands, it's got to be in our heads, or it's got to be in our hearts. So when temptation comes, we have something that we can battle Satan and his lies and the temptations with. We have to remember that we don't have to fall into despair, that evil's not going to win because it's already been defeated in Christ Jesus, that ours is the victory. Number three, mature Christians know the outcome. When I was like 5, maybe. So my brother Steven, he's preached here a couple times, and me and my brother, I mean, all the way growing up, I mean, we just fought and fought and fought. I mean, we hated each other. I mean, just every chance we got. And I don't know what Steven did to me sometime. It was probably super unjustified because I was such a good kid. And he made me really mad. And I don't remember what that was. So when I went out to their garage, I went to my father's workbench and I grabbed a big 16 penny nail, and then I went to our ball pin, bin or whatever, and I grabbed his favorite ball, and then I went and ran around the house and I got in the deck, and underneath the deck where no one could see me, and I just like, and it felt so good. And it was awesome, and I knew, man, he's going to go to play with this thing, and it's not going to be around, because I popped it. And I kid you not, it was a day later, I was home alone, I was the youngest kid, they were off, you know, in school or whatever they were doing, and I loved watching home movies, like my mom and dad would film us with our birthdays or whatever. And I went and grabbed one of the 400 VHS tapes off the shelf, and I popped it in, and I start watching, you know. And it was my birthday from like a year and a half ago. And I was like, oh, this is cool. And I found out that the ball I popped, I actually got for my birthday a year and a half ago. And I popped my own ball. And I was ticked off. I don't believe it. And I think that's a lot how temptation is like. Is it feels so good for a moment. And when it's all said and done, we're left with less than what we even started with in the first place. You still can. Go back to James chapter 1 again. Chapter 14, we are, or verse 14 in chapter 1, and we'll move on to 15 too. I'll read them both. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. First of all, I want to say this. There's some of you that are here that are feeling guilty, maybe, for what they've been tempted with or with the desires that they maybe, if you know, they've had. I'm saying you don't have to feel guilty about being tempted. Being tempted for something isn't sin. When we give into the desire and meet that desire, then it gets conceived to sin. And as mature Christians, we have to know that when we give into temptation, what's really on the other side is death. When we give in to temptations, we have to know that it's not everything it looks like, that there's consequences attached. And mature Christians will know this, that even though that looks good, I can see right through it. I can see it's just a big facade and that there's going to be consequences and pain waiting for the other side. We got to see that the hook that's in front of it, it's not just the shiny, you know, worm that looks good. There's a hook that's underneath it. And it's going to catch us and it's going to get us entangled. And the short-term desire that a temptation will offer, we have to realize that it won't ever compare to what Jesus Christ has already done and offered for us. And the pleasure that we get in obeying Christ, that pleasure will far exceed the temporary satisfaction of giving into temptation. Mature Christians learn from their own past and the past of others. That we don't have to just keep walking through the same exact thing. Oh, well, last time I stepped, I mean, Dave always does a great example of like touching a stove, right? It's like, oh, burn my hand, ow, burn my hand, ow, burn, and you just keep, no, we got to learn from it. The stove's hot. There's certain areas in our life that we got to just avoid, like we talked about earlier. That we got to learn from our past mistakes. We know what it's actually going to offer us. The problem is that, you know, the enemy keeps changing baits on us constantly. Oh, that's not getting you anymore? Well, let me pull this in front of you. My dad always says when we fish in South Dakota, you can use two poles in South Dakota. So he's always, I'm fishing Dakota style. You know, he's always excited. I think Satan's got like 9 poles out in front of us. And oh, that's not biting today? Well, let me switch it up here. Let's put this on the hook. Maybe that'll catch you. We can't just learn from our own past, but the past of others. I tell the youth all the time that there's 2 teachers in life. One's wisdom and one's consequence. And consequence, it's a really hard and tough teacher. Wisdom, learning from other people, learning from God's word, it's got a front-end cost. It takes a little bit of diligence and looking into, but it saves us a whole lot of pain. Now, we'll maybe learn the same exact lesson from the consequences, but man, we got to walk through a long path that's going to be rough. We got to understand. We got to look at what it's actually offering, and we got to see that God's promises are so far better than the empty promises that the devil's offering right there. So mature Christians have to see the outcome of our temptation. It's not all what it looks to be. And you're not going to get off for free. There's going to be baggage attached to it every single time if it's not according to what Christ calls us to. Because remember, Christ doesn't call us to it to be a slave master who's just like, I want you to do what I say or else. He doesn't want us to go into brokenness. He doesn't want us to go to these things, not because they're going to make us happy. He doesn't want us to go there because he too sees the consequences. He too sees the brokenness that's attached to them. And he wants to keep us from it. The last one today is mature Christians know the gospel. And we have to stay rooted in the gospel of Christ because we will fail time and time again. And when we fail, instead of trying to polish ourselves back up or fixing ourselves, we have to rely on the gospel of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of our sins. And when we realize on that and we understand the gospel, it gives us fuel. It gives us a mindset that, yes, God, thank you for forgiving my past. Now I'm excited for my future. I'm going to do all I can to serve you in the future, not because I have to, because I get to, because you've done so much for me. It says in Psalm 34:8, taste and see that the Lord is good. And I believe that a lot of us here have tasted and seen that the Lord is really good. His ways are good. Nothing else. We can keep trying these other things, these other areas of our life that Satan's tempting us with, that our desires really want, that we really think looks good, but they're not going to fill us the way Christ fills us. No matter what the promise of the temptation it's, that's in front of us, it's not going to even compare to the promise that Jesus Christ is offering us every single day. And now when we look at temptation, we can laugh. When you understand what really he's offering you, whatever is really sitting in front of you, you can laugh because we know that we have already had the best. That nothing can compare to Jesus Christ and his arms that are wrapped around us already. It's like, I've got Jesus. I don't need any of that. So today my prayer for all of us is that we can have sober self-assessment of ourselves, that we can understand kind of where we fail and where we succeed. That we don't just keep wandering into jail cells and try to stumble our way out of them, that we can be wise enough to see what's coming ahead and take another path. My prayer for us is that we can see all that Jesus truly has to offer us, because if we have a true understanding of what Jesus has to offer us, there's no way we would ever look anywhere else for anything. So let's pray just that to close. Dear God, we thank you for being the victor over temptation, being the victor over evil, God. We're just walking through this battle, Lord, knowing the outcome. But God, every single day, we don't want our witness, we don't want our faith walks to be hindered by these temptations that we know better from, yet the desires just look so good that we keep falling into them, Lord. Give us the heart and the strength, God. Let us lean not on our own heart, not on our own strength, but give us your strength so we can look at these areas of our lives and bypass them, God. Let us have a truthful and pure understanding of who you are, Jesus, what you have to offer us. Because if we do, I have no doubt that we'll always choose you. Why could we, how could we ever choose anything else when the Lord of the universe has offered us everything and all things? So God, let us move forward today, God, not in fear, but in excitement, Lord, knowing that we have the Lord of the universe on our side. If he is for us, who can be against us? We pray for wisdom, God. You ask us to pray for wisdom in your words. We pray for that for all of us, myself included. God, give us wisdom. We're done doing it our way, and we're excited to do it your way. It's in your name we pray these things. Amen.